So we're at Parashat Yitro. Thanks. Thank you. Vodka? No. Too early. We're at Parashat Yitro, and it is pretty cold out. It is going to be 8 degrees Fahrenheit, which is minus 13 Celsius. With the wind, it's going to be minus 10 Fahrenheit, minus 23 Celsius.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. It is cold out. However, the great chulent Mr. Aryev made for us here in the Torah, we are okay. Bourbon, I'll have it home. Bourbon, I'll have it home. Perfect. So, Parashat Yitro, we have the epic story of the Ten Commandments. Right? It's really, really amazing. You know, Kadosh Baruch Hu, God Himself, comes down and to this world, to give Am Yisrael the Torah, to establish the covenant through giving the Torah of between Am Yisrael and HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You know, first of all, it's interesting. We're always talking about HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us a har kegigit. He put hand the mountain over our heads like a barrel. You know, yes, yes, no, no, I'll drop it over you. I mean, HaKadosh Baruch Hu himself comes down. How can you say no? I just like don't understand that. It's just like, just the thought about it. I mean, of course they would say yes. How could you say no? But, you know, before HaKadosh Baruch Hu, in different cases, HaKadosh Baruch Hu had already had established covenants with humans, but this time is different. Noach, Avraham Avinu, etc., in a way, did not have a free choice. HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave them a commandment. Build a teva, do this, you know, have circumcision, and so on and so forth. But this is this time is different completely, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants this partnership with Am Yisrael. And it seems like Am Yisrael, on its behalf, agreeing, and it says, Naaseh, or Naaseh v'nishma, we shall do and listen, hear, whatever. And if so, if it's so wonderful, why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu had suspended a mountain in a way over the heads of Am Yisrael, take it, or I'll drop it? That's very nice. It's like a shotgun wedding, you know? What kind of a free choice is that? What's going on here? I mean, this whole event is quite interesting, it's quite fascinating. It is, of course, the first time in human history that HaKadosh Baruch Hu had revealed himself, or there was a divine revelation in front of a whole entire nation. It's the first time in human history. First time. Because until that point, there were individuals who spoke to God, claimed God spoke to them after that as well. That could always be disputed. I mean, for example, a guy comes to you and says, you know, God spoke to me. Today you tell him, excuse me, you're having a psychotic break or something. Well, what's the matter with you? You know, you would say the guy is crazy. Or if, let's say somebody comes to you and says, you know, I saw an alien spaceship. You say, mm-hmm. What did you lace your coffee with? You know, alien spaceship, what are you, crazy? However, if let's say two people came and says, you know, we saw an alien spaceship. So you say, well, you guys are pulling my leg or something, what's wrong with you? Imagine you're in the middle of Fifth Avenue. The day before, I don't know, Thanksgiving or something like this. Or, I don't know, one of those busy days, and you have 500,000 people seeing without a doubt a UFO. At that point, you can't say, well, everybody's crazy. It is a testimony of 500,000 people. The problem that many people have with that is that few million people, let's say a million people, okay? Let's say a million people, even though we had 600,000 men from the age of 20 to the age of 50, but let's say it's a million people. This event of Kabbalat HaTorah, receiving the Torah, is engraved into the Jewish DNA to such an extent that to deny it is like denying your own self. I'll tell you the following. Many people have doubts whether they are alive or not. But you cannot deny the fact the Torah was given on Har Sinai. It is very important to understand that, because there are trends in Judaism today that reject the whole notion that Am Yisrael by itself exists on. For example, conservative and reform Judaism denounce the fact that God, first of all, that there is a God, and he gave the Torah to Am Yisrael, revealed himself in Har Sinai, and so on and so forth. Therefore, what in the world makes you a Jew if not that event? How could you deny it? I mean, we could dispute whether our commander-in-chief is really functioning as a president or an American president. You know, that you could dispute politics, you could dispute, but you can't dispute the fact that God came down and received it. You can say whatever you want to say about the Jews. Stupid, they're not. And cannot be that someone in the middle of the Jewish history had invented this idea that something like this had happened, because the Jews would say, listen, hey, Habibi, you know, not us. Go tell somebody else, not us. This is the event in which Am Yisrael is built on. So if you're denying that event, you're denying your Jewish existence, because from that point and on, the Jews became Jews. That's what makes the Jews Jews, receiving the Torah on Har Sinai, creating the what we call the Torah Shebichtav, the written Torah. And you know, in conservative Reform Judaism, first it was the announcement of oral Torah, then it's the written Torah. Somebody wrote it over a period of time. There were some guys who were sitting down in Babylon. They were smoking dope and they were having a good time. And Ketov Livon Bayayin, between one Sheshbesh game or playing checkers to another, they decided to write down a couple of stories to spread it to the people, because there's nothing better to do. I mean, that's the most idiotic thing, or one of the most idiotic things I ever heard in my life. Secular Jews will tell you, yeah, there was a Torah, so on and so forth. Denouncing the event of Har Sinai comes from a very rotten place. Very. So have this in mind, and don't be afraid to deliver a 1-2 punch for whoever, I mean, not physical, of course, but to give a And Maagari. Where's Sensei? What's Maagari? Front kick. But you don't look. Yeah, Maagari. Yeah, front kick, yeah. A debilitating. Huh?
Yeah, my sensei had a different way of saying
it. Yeah, how do you say it?
I just forgot.
Why do you even forget? You're a black belt. How'd you forget? All right, I gotta speak to you outside if you forgot this. We have to do a review here. I'll give you to the review board. Anyway, so this is how important Matan Torah is, and I'm sure you're going to come across people who would give you wise remarks over that, and then ask them, you know, at what point did you stop becoming a Jew and became a, I don't know, jerk. I'm not politically correct. I don't believe in political correctness. There's no such thing as politically correct. You gotta say the truth. Why is it that only one side can say the truth and the other can't? You can push everything down my throat and I cannot open my mouth? Excuse me, it doesn't work like that. How did they say it in downtown Queens? Who died and left you king, right? I'm very upset over these things because it's like crust inside the soul of our nation that slowly, slowly makes things fall apart. That's what you're standing for. That's your birth. We could dispute whether your mother is your mother or your father is your father, but we cannot dispute that God himself came down and gave us the Torah. End of the story. So of course then, why do we need to give this free choice, this Har Kigigit? So, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, before and after Matan Torah and the covenant, tells Moshe Rabbeinu to check really if the people are willing to become partners in this covenant. And of course, it's a very, very deep idea. Why? Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants Am Yisrael to practice his Torah and to worship him from free choice, and they would freely choose him. And it's a tremendous idea that unfortunately many of our leaders today, what we call leaders, are not really leaders, because they want you to vote for them, but then they forget you right after that. You becoming a servant. Instead of they becoming public servants, you become a servant for the electors. I wish politicians would work as hard for us as we work for them, with paying taxes and so on and so forth. I wish. Mm-hmm. So, Bnei Israel were asked the question, are you ready for this deal? So the question is, how do they say that they agree to this deal? In Sefer Shmot, in Perek Yudchet, in the 18th chapter, verse 8, they say, Ve'yanu kol ha'am yachtav, together, Vayanu kol ha'am yachdav, together they said, Kol asher diber Hashem, we shall do. Na'aseh. Everything Hashem asks us, we will do. And that was before the covenant. After that, in Perek Chavdalev, Pasuk Gimel, it says, Vayavon Moshe vayisaper la'am et kol diber Hashem, and Moshe came to the people and he told them whatever Hashem said, ve'et kol ha'mishpatim, and all the laws, Vayan kol ha'am kol echad, with one voice, the people answer him with one voice. Vayomru kol ha'dvarim asher diber Hashem, na'aseh, we shall do. So, ma zeh na'aseh v'nishma, tachshevu tov. But the third time is in pasuk zayin, ve'ikach sefer ha'brit, and he took the book of covenant. And he read it into the people's ears, he read it to them, and they says, Vayanu, na'aseh v'nishma. So I understand this na'aseh. Okay, we'll do it, no problem, we'll do it. But what is this addition, na'aseh v'nishma? We shall do and we should hear. Should be other way around. Let us hear and then we'll do. Here they say, na'aseh v'nishma. So either you say, we shall hear and we shall do, or just do what you said we'll do and then we'll hear. It doesn't make sense. So, a few weeks ago, HaKadosh Baruch Hu said to Moshe Rabbeinu, Shamati et na'akat b'nei Israel. I heard what b'nei Israel were crying. But in Sefer Bereshit, when we have the story of Migdal Bavel, HaKadosh Baruch Hu Leman Lo Yishmeu, in order for them not to listen, Ish Sfat Re'u. So we understand the Shmia is Shmia. Listening is to listen. Shamati et nakat bnei Yisrael. So okay, listening is listening. But if you bring the text of Migdal Bavel, means Shmia, to hear, is to understand. As it says in Masechet Chagiga, right? There is a story in Masechet Chagiga whether a person who is deaf could understand and so on and so forth, right? And the story of the two people in the neighborhood, the Rabban Gamliel, etc. Rabban Gamliel, I think, right? Or whoever it was, Rabbi Yochanan, I don't remember. I'm like a little out of it. Huh?
Not good with names.
Whatever. I'm just like a little out. So the question is, if you hear something, can you understand? That's why it's very important to pay attention, because you don't pay attention in class, your college, you don't understand. And then you stay, thick as a brick. But there is a big difference. There's a big difference. And the difference is that the first two times it says also Bekol echad veyachdav, in one voice, and they say together. And Bashlishi, the third one, there's no description. They just says, everybody says, Naseh, they said Nishma, 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 like echoing each other, said Nishma. They didn't say in one voice, or they didn't say together. And the point of a matter is that this is the greatest difference between Judaism and other types of religions. First of all, one needs to understand that Judaism is not a religion. Judaism is a way of life. If it's religion, it's they need to have theology. We don't have theology. In other words, those who choose to live life. Ari, come here. Nice boots. Those who choose to live life as a Jew are Jews. We said many, many times, what separates a Jew from a Gentile? Torah and mitzvot. What happens when you don't keep Torah and mitzvot? You can't come and claim to me that you are a full-fledged Jew just like me, because you're not. I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. You're not. If I pay taxes and I have an income and you have an income but don't pay taxes, hey, we don't have the same rights here. You're a criminal. I'm not. Why do you think that a person who does not keep Torah and mitzvot has the same right to say things the way I say it? Why do you think that you could interpret Judaism? Based on what? Ari, what happened here? All of a sudden got locked. You understand? You have it many times, people would argue with you, and I would say, what right do you have to argue? And what right could you argue? Are you doing anything? Are you living your life? Are you learning at all? Every Jew is a chief rabbi. My dear friends, in order to be a chief rabbi, you have to learn a lot. And you have to know what you're talking. You don't get your education from talkbacks on Facebook or whatever it is, you know. You want to have a saying? Well, practice. You don't contribute? Shut up. Or your opinion simply does not count. I know I sound very harsh, but guys, let's be practical. And this is how you finish many arguments very quickly. When you practice Judaism, you have to, you don't like things, change it, but you need to be a part of it. Do I have any right to say, for example, things in France don't operate the way I want it to be? And you guys need to change it. By the way, that's what America does to many places in the world, right? Really, if you think about it, what right the United States have to tell Israel, make peace with this one, make peace with that one? Who asked you? I don't want you. Well, what do you say? Based on what? It's a little, you know, they got a nerve. You finish working on America? That's the arguments that you hear. Many times you go outside of the United States about Americans. You don't vote? Don't complain, but you get a bad leader. That's the way things are. And it's something for us to remember. If you don't share, you don't help to carry the burden, you don't have any rights to say anything. So what Am Yisrael is doing here, it is very, very interesting. Because the difference is that Judaism distinguished between emunah, belief, and maaseh, action. Between doing and understanding. Judaism, as we said, does not have a theology. Judaism has laws. And only when you're living things, you have laws. That's why there's a big difference between Judaism and Christianity. There are laws in Christianity of how to do certain things. Islam adopted things from everywhere. They took from everybody. However, Judaism is a way of life. If you want to live like an American, you have to abide to the Constitution. Some people in Capitol Hill don't agree with that, but that's a different case. However, if you're an American, you don't have anything to do with the French law or English law or British law or Saudi law. Whatever they want to do, they want to do. If the people don't like it, you know, let them change it. So Judaism has laws, and it is a fundamental difference between Judaism and other types of religion. Fundamental. Judaism is based on actions, on doing certain things. Mitzvot aseh. Things you need to do. How many mitzvot aseh? 248. Keminyan? Ramach. Keminyan? Avraham. Avraham, Ramach, and mitzvot aseh is the same thing. Avraham Avinu used to do things. That's why 248. The same numerical value. Mitzvot lo ta'aseh, don't do? 365. Man, you were paying attention this morning. Remember, we said it this morning. 365. Keminyan shasa. Shasa gidim veramach evarim. Basically, you could fulfill all the mitzvot of the Torah with every limb of your body. That's the representation that the human, that the person, is olam umloh, the whole entire Torah, is within your body. There isn't a limb in your body that you cannot do a mitzvah with. Even when you take the whole entire body as one big unit, you do a mitzvah with it. You go into the sukkah, one mitzvah, you do with the whole body. Right? Every hand, everything is a mitzvah. Left hand we put tefillin, right hand we hold the lulav, etc., 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 etc. Two legs we walk for bet midrash. Right? Put the ringer on the finger. So Judaism is based, most of the laws of Judaism is again how to live life. Why? How do people interact with each other? I'm not supposed to teach you, I'm supposed to respect you. You're supposed to respect the interaction between humans. And in other words, if we apply and we live by the laws of the Torah, in other words, let's look at it this way. The Torah is a method, a manual of how to bring a Kadosh Baruch Hu into your life, into your actions, into yourself. If you don't do that, a Kadosh Baruch Hu is a stranger, Chas v'Shalom, standing outside of your house, looking from the outside in, you don't let him in. Even the interaction of a small scale. Let's say you have how to act with the people, the non-Jews. He has a way to interact with them. Betzelem Elokim. You have to, in a certain manner. Those, then you have people who are closer to you. Ger, Yatom, Almana, your resident aliens, and so on and so forth. The widows, the poor people. Then you have your own people. Then you have your own family. Then there's interaction between a person and his wife, a person and his kids, and the interaction between a person and himself. For example, Bal Teshaketsu, don't do things who would repulse you, who will disgrace your own self-image. You're not supposed to do it. In other words, every single thing is geared to bring a Kadosh Baruch Hu into my life. If I don't see a Kadosh Baruch Hu into my life, means I did not let him in. I am therefore lacking and missing in this mitzvah, whatever that mitzvah there will be. If I am praying and in my prayer I don't feel as I am talking to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that means that I'm not praying to Him. If I'm keeping Shabbat and I don't feel the excitement for Shabbat, means I didn't keep Shabbat for HaKadosh Baruch Hu. I kept it because I didn't want to work. I kept it because I don't want my neighbors to talk about me. And any other things. I did not allow HaKadosh Baruch Hu into my Shabbat. You have to think about it. Every action, that's the difference. That's why Judaism is so powerful. It's very powerful. You can't, if you are a truthful Jew, you can't cheat. And you don't cheat, not because you want to go to sleep at night, but because you don't want to worry about the IRS. Because it's wrong to cheat. It's wrong to steal. Because there are greater things than you. What is the great thing with you? Kiddush Hashem. Sanctify Hashem's name. You got to be very careful. I never seen a guy, let's say for example a lawyer, right? He's a lawyer or whatever, I don't know, whatever, a businessman. They never say an Irish American was just caught robbing a bank. Or an Italian American was just caught, I don't know, human trafficking. An Orthodox Jew was caught that right away. And you know what? Rightfully so. Why? Because you should know better. You should know better. Think about it. We have the right. HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us the right to interact, to bring Him into our lives, and we should know better. And that is, as much as HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and you know, we have to bring Him into our private life, we have to bring HaKadosh Baruch Hu into our society, and to create a better society, and a better place of worship. And if you have a congregation, or shul, or something, that there is no Yirat Shamayim there, means there's no Torah there. I'm sorry to say that. For whatever reason, there's no Torah there. There's no Torah there, no Kadosh Baruch Hu there. I don't know what you're doing. There's a bingo hall. It's not a shul. How can you fight in a shul? It's all about Torah, Rabotai. Torah is the key to your life. That's it. That's it. There's no way around it. When you don't learn, you say to Kadosh Baruch Hu, Shalom, please, leave me now. I'm busy. I'm going to ask you this. One day you're going to meet HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Why are you going to tell him? If you dedicate your life, it's like seeing a good friend or some beloved person in your life. You're looking forward all your life to see him. Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem. Thank you. Finally, all my life I worked to see you. When you come to see HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you'll do whatever you can not to look at him. All my life you're fighting. But it's not going to help you. You're going to see him. What are you going to do? What kind of life is that? Running away all your life. You can't run away from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You were made a partner. And as a partner, you have a responsibility. Many partnerships don't work because either they view themselves above the partnership or they don't want to put or accept the responsibility of the partnership. To be a partner means to be responsible. Unfortunately today, the word husband, wife, and so on and so forth, because of political correctness, it's like I'm saying, my mistress, right? Nobody would say my mistress. Today, nobody would say, my wife, she's my partner. Why? Because there are other kinds of partnership. But in those partnerships that are against what HaKadosh Baruch Hu had asked for us not to do, there is no Kedusha, there is no holiness, God is not there. I don't care how many rabbi with skirts you have there, putting like I don't know what on their hands, wearing the talita I don't know who wore, there's no Kedusha in that matter. Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu does not like it. If he doesn't like it, he doesn't approve of it, he's not going to come. You're just basically faking. You're playing a role in a movie. You got to be very careful. Pornography is another thing. HaKadosh Baruch Hu does not like. You can have a mezuzah Moshe Rabbeinu wrote. Ezra Sofer. He wrote a mezuzah size of the Sefer Torah on every single door. You spent a lot of money for that. Everything, silver cups like this, the Holy Grails. The whole 9 yards. No, I don't know if the Holy Grail is 9 yards, but you know. You go to a funky website, Allah, Kadosh Baruch Hu, Achutza, it goes out. I don't want to be here. You gotta be aware of that. Because a person needs to work hard to appropriate. If you have somebody important coming to your house, the president of the United States and shish kebab. Sure. Come into your house. Doesn't make a difference. You like him, you don't like him, you're Democrat, Republican. Still, a person of that magnitude would say, Dr. Daniel, I'm coming to your house.
Better, better if you don't.
No, you won't say that. You won't say it.
I can't stand him.
No, that's something else. I would say, listen, he's still the president of the United States, you know. I would say, b'chavod, I will clean the house, I'll make sure. I'm telling you the truth. I'm not a Democrat. I'm a hardcore conservative.
Yeah.
I didn't say Republican, conservative. But still, he is the president of the United States. And I will clean my house, make sure everything is perfect, put everything away, wash all the laundry, clean all the corners of the house. It is an important person coming to my house. Now let me ask you this. Who is more important? Okay, you know what? Putin coming to your house. You let Putin in. I let him in. I like Putin. I think he's great. Putin, he's a good guy. Likes judo. This is my kind of guy. Anyway. Good thing it's not during McCarthy. They will put me in jail for that, you know, witch hunting. Anyway. A person of that magnitude coming to your house, you clean your house, you make sure your house is clean. A Kadosh Baruch Hu is coming to your house. I'm not saying clean the house like in the corners like this. But are you going to clean your house? Is your house going to be clean or your house is going to be dirty? HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, I'll come into your community. Is your community clean? You think that if you fight or you argue in shul, HaKadosh Baruch Hu is there to listen to your babbling? He doesn't care if you sing. He doesn't care if David HaMelech sang. He doesn't care Shirot v'tishbuchot and singing and bring drums and I don't know, bring Uri, I don't know, Uri Bitan, bring whoever you want. HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, I don't want to be here. Better off, you daven quick and go home. Nobody fights, nobody talks, than to stay in shul 3-4 hours, thinking you are singing Sanremo, music festivals, and everybody talks. It's not a shul anymore. It's a matter if you go to Carnegie Hall. Can have a corned beef sandwich afterwards. Better off. But let me ask you a question. HaKadosh Baruch Hu is going to come into yourself. Are you cleaning yourself? Are you cleaning house? Are you at least busy working cleaning the house? Are you taking the garbage out? Would you let somebody, I don't know, the chief rabbi, okay? Let's say Rav Ovadia Yosef will come to your house. Are you going to take the garbage out? Or you just leave it there to stink for like a week? Your socks all the way down to the basement when they do laundry. Although Rebbe, when he was alive, when he was alive. Right? Even if you come without dollars, you'll clean the house, right? And that's what I'm trying to explain to you about Judaism, about letting HaKadosh Baruch Hu in. The vehicle, the chip that allows us to do that download, that thing is Torah. And that's what we have to remember. Now, in other words, what we are doing when we're learning Torah, what we are doing, it's what the Ramchal writes, Chovat HaAdam Be'olamo. In order to understand that, you need to understand what is your job in this world. What are you obligated to do as a Jew? And your obligation as a Jew is to be Mekadesh Shem Shamayim, to sanctify Hashem's name. I know, you're not supposed to look at women or to walk behind a woman. However, if you are in a society that does not share the same values, if you're going to take the door, open the door, and slam it at this woman's face, it's going to be a problem. So you got to be aware. It's not a holy place. Now we need to do what? We can't run away from it. This is our job. We need to bring the light into the darkness. When we were talking about opnimi in Kabbalah, internal light and external light, we need to bring that light into our lives. When we are talking about the purity of the matter, and if you don't understand what I'm talking about, go to our lecture that talks about spiritual light. Because believe that we're going to take Kabbalistic concepts and actually try to explain it to you so you would have an understanding what we're talking about. In order to make the light from inside shine, you need to cleanse the vessel to make it less brute, more refined. So if there is a case like that, and let's say she's a very attractive woman, so you open the door and just close your eyes. Let her pass. Or don't look. Say, please, b'chavod. Don't be overly holy, because then you are doing it for yourself. You're doing it for your name. You're not doing it for Hashem's name. And that is what Am Yisrael did. When Am Yisrael says Na'aseh twice, they say it Bekol Echad, twice. They say it in one voice. They say it together. Then HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave it to them. He says, yes, we're willing. HaKadosh Baruch Hu came. But once again, what's the Na'aseh? What is the Na'aseh? The Na'aseh is the beauty of Judaism. Na'aseh is the beauty of accepting. Nishma is the greater beauty of Judaism. And why is that? As long as we are loyal to the word, as long as we are loyal to the Torah, to the laws of the Torah, that we are all here joining the same task, the Nishma that we will hear, that they did not answer in one voice, comes to indicate to us something very different. Because we say Shmiah is Havana, understanding. And everybody understands whatever the Torah says one way or another. As long as, of course, that we are staying loyal to the text by interpreting the Torah according to the 13 Midot Shatoran Nidreshet Bahem, to the 13 principles in which you could develop and manipulate the Torah. And that is a tremendous new idea that is new to the world then and today. There is no open discussion. There may be the only other example to such an open discussion, maybe, of course not on the same level, is the American Constitution. A lot of the American identity of what this country, what this nation is about, is based on concepts that are found in the biblical Torah, in the Old Testament and the Holy Testament for that matter, where you are entitled to interpreting things your way and I'm entitled to my way, and it's not a battle but who is going to overpower the other, as it says in the Gemara. Those ignorant people who don't understand the Gemara appropriately, everything is a machloket, everything they fight about, Jews always fight. That's not true. When the Gemara records the arguments or the different give and take, it's not arguments, the give and take of two, three or more sages is to first of all show you that every opinion counts, and every opinion helps to reveal another layer to reach to the core truth, which is the halakha, because they're not arguing about I am greater than you, you are lower than me, and so on and so forth, which is basically the same thing, right? The argument is how together we are coming down to the core, to the truth, to find the truth. How do we together bring HaKadosh Baruch Hu into our lives? To show you that every opinion counts and every opinion matters. However, within the boundaries of the law, you cannot, for example, take the American Constitution and interpret it according to Mexican law. That it does not work. So therefore, if you want to have your voice heard in the Torah, you first of all need to keep it. You need to be able to interpret it according to, and that is a new concept. Judaism created a revolution here in that matter. But just quickly, why again? And that's why when we comes to halakha, we all strain up a line. Everything is the same. Halakha is halakha. Because the arguments are good, but it's all done. And then we all coming down to the halakha. But why did he put this har kigigit? Har kigigit, to make a small section, because tomorrow, Bezat Hashem, I'll expand further on that. Tomorrow, we're going to do a Kabbalistic approach, Bezat Hashem, on why did he put the mountain like that. But is very simple, because the Na'aseh V'Nishma is very nice, it's a great idea. But after that, we say, okay, let's look for meaning in that. And if not everything is understood and clear to me, either because I didn't find a meaning to it, or not because everything I asked for was answered, and so on and so forth, so guess what? You know what? I don't understand that. You couldn't answer it. Guess what? I'm not doing it. So if the halakha of ben sorer or more, or why a person becomes a mamzer, a bastard, you know, I don't understand that. So guess what? I'm not keeping this. But that's the problem. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu, make them understand that it's very nice that you're doing Na'aseh V'Nishma. However, there are consequences to your doing. And you should know one thing. That when you do the b'chira, when you're choosing, and it is, and you know, we all talk about free choice, and so on and so forth. But everything has to be rational. But when we drop this rationale, you know, that we always try to go by, oh, that makes sense, so if it doesn't make sense, I don't do that. All of a sudden, when I'm trying to do things because of emunah, of belief, all of a sudden you find a new meaning to do things. It's a higher level. First you do things only because it makes sense. But when you understand things on a different level, you're doing things because it needs to be done. That's a different understanding whatsoever. The rationale is the noise that we generate in our heads. But when you're able to quiet down this noise, when you are able to quiet down your mind, and you become enlightened, because you understand things on a totally different scale, as we say in the morning, those are the moments when time would stop for you, where you could sit and contemplate on a matter or an idea, and you won't even notice that 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 hours had gone by. You are immersed in that. Somebody would think you were daydreaming, but you're not. When you reach this level of doing, then you have the concept of hearing the voices. But in our case, he's hearing the lights and seeing the voices. How could that be achieved? When they ra'u et hakolot, they saw the... How could that be achieved? Very simple. HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, there is going to be a consequence. I'm going to put the mountain over your heads to allow you to quiet down your mind and to develop your emunah. Work on your emunah and you'll see the sound and you hear the colors, and Bezat Hashem, come and check us tomorrow and we'll get it further. So Shabbat Shalom.